Hello, and welcome to my presentation, Star Wars, A New Hope for Primary Analysis in the Social Studies Classroom. I am your presenter, Matt Stevenson, out of the University of Tennessee at Knoxville. I'm in the Theory and Practice and Teacher Education Department with a focus on Social Studies. The purpose of this presentation is to provide a demonstration of the impact and challenges for using film in the Social Studies classroom. The intended audience here is current and future social studies teachers, as well as teacher educators and classroom researchers. I'm also looking to reach out to classroom stakeholders, including administrators, parents, and students, and really just film enthusiasts in general. The agenda for this presentation is to first start with a brief literature and vocabulary review, followed by a broad overview of feature films as a classroom source. This will lead us into a limited demonstration with some reflection, which is, could your students do what we are doing with these films? And are we training our interns and new teachers to understand and to address the complexity of the use of film in social studies classrooms? When it comes to academic sources dealing with this particular topic, the two sources I've chosen to highlight are the Marcus et al. Teaching History with Film, Strategies for Secondary Social Studies, as well as the Russell and Waters Cinematic Social Studies, a resource for teaching and learning social studies with film. Sources agree that social studies teachers are using film on a very regular basis. Even your own anecdotal evidence from the classroom, whether it's your classroom, whether it's teachers that you have trained, whether it's teachers you have observed, or just as a student who might remember your history teacher, knows that film is going to be used and that many times the films are not used effectively. Many of us have memories or stories of teachers who simply put a film in just to kill some time, right? They put in a film because it is Substitute Teacher Friday or something along those lines where film becomes a filler rather than an active source for student and curriculum engagement. What exactly are we doing when we utilize films so we can ensure that the use of these films is not simply filler, but actually being done in an effective way? One aspect about this is to understand what we are doing with these films. Why are we showing films in the classroom? Well, most teachers who utilize film in the classroom use film as a text. In other words, they're showing a film or maybe a clip from a film to substitute for other texts, such as a lecture, such as formative assessments, such as an actual textbook. This can be effective, but only if it is done correctly and only if it is done with legitimate intent. However, many teachers, even those with really good intentions, will show a film, and then once it's done, they'll simply say, "See? Did everybody catch that? Okay, let's move on." And so what ends up happening is the film is not actually supplementing a lesson, it's replacing a lesson, and because of the lack of engagement with it as a legitimate source, it is not usually getting the method across, or at least not getting it across in an effective manner. And that's where these other details come into play. The other ways that film can be utilized, such as using a film as an analogy. This helps to develop interpretive skills. Using film to demonstrate historiography, providing multiple perspectives on a particular historical topic. Film as a depictor of atmosphere. This can create, as the Marcus et al. Source describes, empathy for a historical time period or historical characters. Film can also be utilized as a springboard into discussion of difficult issues. Regardless of how the film is going to be used, the film does need to have specific plans for that particular curriculum. In other words, you can't just simply put the film in and expect it to speak for itself. Just like any lesson planning in a social studies classroom or other classrooms for that matter, there needs to be a very intent method by which this film will be used as a source in order to create better engagement, but also to make sure you are contributing to the academic discussion. For this, the best example that I've looked at is what's known as the Russell Method. The Russell Method, which again, relatively simple, and you would think somewhat intuitive, is something that often doesn't occur within the social studies classroom when they engage with films. This involves four stages. The preparation stage, this is laying out what exactly needs to be done with the film, what exactly is the curriculum this is contributing to, what is the lesson ahead of time before we get to the film. A previewing stage, this involves both viewing the film outside the classroom for the teacher in order to understand what exactly you want to get out of this film and how you're going to utilize it, as well as discussing with the students in the class before the film is shown what they should be looking for, what they could expect out of this. There's the watching stage, which, again, that sounds pretty intuitive. You just put the film in and you watch it, right? Well, not necessarily. During the watching stage, this could be done asynchronously. In other words, students are expected to watch the film on their own. Maybe it's posted somewhere. Maybe there's an after-school viewing party. Maybe the students are expected to access the film themselves. This works better if you were at a college library that might have subscriptions to streaming services, these kinds of things. Or this could involve watching the film in the classroom, which that consumes a lot of time, particularly if you're going to try to watch an entire film. I typically am a fan of watching the film in the classroom. And again, this takes a lot of time, but I always preface this with my students by saying, I will show the entire film as long as you accept the fact that I'm going to be talking through the entire thing. Because watching the film itself needs to be an active process. Simply putting it in there and expecting it to speak for itself for 2 hours or more is, again, not going to be an effective strategy. And this, of course, is followed up by the post-viewing stage. This is where there is a discussion and an assessment of what was seen. This is not in either of the sources, although they both talk about what is necessary for the post-viewing stage. But for my personal practices, I like to stick by the rule of however long the film is you're watching, you need to spend at least that amount of time discussing the film. That means if you're going to show a 2-hour film in the classroom, you better be prepared to have 2 hours of discussion thereafter. Once again, this is a lot of class time. Can you devote that kind of time to a particular topic? If yes, hit it. Go for it. If not, then maybe you need to cut this down to just a few short clips. You show a 5-minute clip, a 5-minute conversation. This can be contributing very effectively to whatever other lesson plans you have in place. But this needs to be very well planned out and very well thought out before engaging with the film in the classroom. As this presentation continues, there will be occasional references to standards. I don't plan to engage much with these standards, but the ones that I've pulled from for those who might find this useful for their purposes come from the advanced placement standards of both modern world history and European history. Now, we're talking about film as a source in the classroom. This is a question I typically put out there to my students, which is, if we were talking about films like, say, The Last Samurai or A Bridge Too Far, Last Samurai being, for instance, about the Meiji Restoration in Japan, or A Bridge Too Far about World War II, what kind of source is this? Is this a primary source, or is this a secondary source? Now, students should recognize pretty quickly that these are secondary sources about the events they are depicting. Tom Cruise was not involved in the Samurai Rebellion of 1877. Right? Sean Connery might have been alive during World War II, but he was not in Operation Market Garden. Therefore, these, in commentary to the material they are discussing, film as text, they are in fact secondary sources. But then I continue this questioning with students, which is, how do we turn them into primary sources? Now, those listening to this presentation know that this is about using film as primary sources. Most of the professionals, I think, who would engage with this would probably recognize, well, you cannot make The Last Samurai, the film, a primary source about the Meiji Restoration, right? Schindler's List is not a primary source about World War II and about the Holocaust, right? Liam Neeson is not Oscar Schindler, regardless of how well he portrays that particular role. So in order to make them into primary sources, we have to engage instead with the films themselves and the times in which they were created, right? The Last Samurai is a primary source about the film career of Tom Cruise, or Count of Monte Cristo as a primary source about the engagement with classical literature as a feature film in 2002. This is the first stage to layering complexity into our discussion to ensure that our use of film is in fact effective. So what I have here is a rough breakdown shown in these Venn diagrams about how you might utilize various films within the classroom. Basically, what I have set up here is the time periods that are being discussed must interconnect in order to fully engage with these sources effectively. Those time periods include the era in which the film depicts. This, of course, is using film as a basic text to show a historical storyline. So, as you see here on the second chart, The Last Samurai would be depicting the 1877 Meiji Restoration or the Samurai Rebellion. Right? So using Tom Cruise's The Last Samurai film could be a way to some degree engage with what happened in 1877. However, if you're going to continue to understand what happened in 1877, we must recognize that the second part of this is discussing the era in which the film was produced. This film was made in 2003. This is a 2003 interpretation and understanding of what 1877 Samurai Rebellion and Meiji Restoration may have been like. It's more than just simply understanding the time period in which it's produced. It's combining these two time periods to give us a broader historiography. What does 2003 think samurai are supposed to be, particularly when it comes to film representations? But there's a third time period that needs to be addressed, and that is the era in which the film is being viewed. So if you're showing this in a modern classroom, you have to understand we're going to have a modern classroom reaction. We cannot expect modern students of 2023 to engage with a 2003 version of the samurai in order to comment on 1877 Meiji Restoration unless we engage with that particular dynamic directly. How does our modern interpretation of, in this case, a film that is 20 years old, help us to springboard into a discussion of the broader context that's at play here? So this is, again, that breakdown about how we would put things into place. Three different time periods, how they might interact with each other, but only by utilizing all three, in this case of The Last Samurai, 1877, 2003, and 2023, can we in fact turn this into a full primary source? And can we then ensure that the discussion is deep enough to actually be impactful for our students and a good supplement for our lessons? But an interesting question comes up when we start dealing with non-historical fiction film. Thing is, when you have non-historical fiction, you still have the time period in which the film is being viewed. In this case, we'd be talking about a 2023 classroom. You have the era in which the film is being produced, depending on what that film is, right? When is this actually taking place? Those do not change. But the era in which the film depicts, what if this is not a true story? How can this be a depiction of a particular time period? And this is where we shift from discussing a historiography to an analogy. Now, this can take a couple of forms. One quick example here, this will not be the focus for the conversation, but a quick example is the film The Count of Monte Cristo. The film The Count of Monte Cristo is 2002. That is the era of production. If we are viewing this in a 2023 classroom, now you have a springboard into our interpretation of classical literature as it is represented in feature films in 2002. The problem is with Count of Monte Cristo is it's not a true story. It is placed in a historical time period that is interpreted in another historical time period. The time period in which the novel was written is 1844. So the first thing we need to do in order to combine our time periods here into making this into a primary source is recognize that this is a story from 1844. But the next step, that added layer of complexity, is to recognize that the time period it's commenting on is actually much earlier, approximately 1815 to 1830. So you see the multi-layers of complexity that are being placed here. You have a film from 2002 being shown to an audience in 2023 that is commenting on a novel written in 1844, or I should say is a depiction of a novel written in 1844, that is talking about the time period 1815 through 1830. That is a lot of complexity in order to just get the very basics of understanding what this film may contribute to your classroom. But even more entertaining, what happens if it's not a historical storyline at all? And this brings us to our topic for today, which is Star Wars: A New Hope, circa 1977. We do have the first two eras here, of course, the production of the film, 1977, the era in which the film is being viewed, in this case, a 2023 classroom. But it doesn't depict a historical time period. What are we doing with this film? Why would we utilize a film like this that is not even depicting a historical time period? And that is where we really need to dive deep into the analogy. What exactly is Star Wars, A New Hope, an analogy thereof? And with that in mind, I want to go ahead and show the trailer for this film, the 1977 Star Wars, A New Hope, and help us to get into the mindset to begin to start engaging with the complexity of this particular film and what we might expect to do with it in the classroom.
Hello there.
I was once a Jedi Knight, the same as your father. Now the Jedi are all but extinct.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
For over 1,000 generations, the Jedi Knights were the guardians of peace and justice in the Old Republic. Before the Dark Times. Before the Empire.
Now, it's worth considering, as you watch this trailer, how impactful this film is and has been. For my generation, watching even this trailer brings back specific memories of watching this film when I was younger. John Williams' music, the very specific lines that are put into place, the visuals. Yes, this is an older film, but it is something that, again, for my generation has a particularly powerful resonance. But this film really helps with what Marcus and Russell would say is the engagement factor, getting students interested in the subject matter with something that is visually, auditorily very stimulating. So the question that comes to mind then is, how many of you have seen this film? How many of your students do you think have seen this film? And that could be whether you are a college history teacher, or you are a high school social studies teacher, how many of your students have seen the 1977 version? How many of you or how many of your students do you think have engaged with the subsequent versions of Star Wars? Right? It's multi-generational. 1977, the various sequels in the 80s, the prequels of the early 2000s, the interludes and various adaptations of the 2010s, and of course the very popular television shows that are currently out. Not to mention the theme parks like, say, Disney's Hollywood Studios, which opened its Star Wars Galaxy Edge in 2019. Star Wars is the language that many people, multi-generations, can still engage with. So the question is then, how do we use this for our classroom? What exactly can this give us for a social studies classroom? What is the analogy that we would utilize to couple this with a 2023 viewing and a 1977 era of production? So what is the historical analogy? The problem with using a pure fiction film, whether it's science fiction like Star Wars, whether it's fantasy like Lord of the Rings, or something that's somewhere in between like Harry Potter, is it's not basing itself on a specific event, so we have to bridge that gap. What this is a discussion of is the perception of the future as it is conceived of in 1977. Space travel, laser guns, android servants, these kinds of things that are perceived to be part of a future civilization as is conceived of in 1977. And that may be similar, and it may have some significant differences to how we perceive the future here in 2023. But despite the fact that this is a depiction of futuristic technology and futuristic space travel, it's still an analogy for what people in 1977 can understand. They are looking back to comparisons. And that's where the question comes into play. What exactly is the historical analogy here? Well, some authors and some discussions have said that this is an analogy of Rome, right? This could easily be the story of Rome, the fall of a republic and the rise of an empire that then expands out and takes over multiple territories with a brutal military and unlimited force. That sort of analogy certainly does seem pretty clear. There are those who might connect this analogy to decolonization. The film comes out in 1977. Empire seems to be a bad word. Definitely could be something that we see as part of the historical analogy. What I like to do with this in particular is to deal with this in terms of the historical good guys and historical bad guys. So if we're talking about who are the historical good and bad actors that are analogous to the empire that we see here in Star Wars, so what if I want to use this film to teach a lesson on historical good guys and bad guys? Well, in this case, the analogy now becomes pretty clear of where we can go with this as far as the true historical bad guys of the 1977 American mindset, and that is going to be the Nazis. There's a lot in this film that helps to understand the empire to some degree could be an analogy for the Nazis. They practice genocide. They are originally militaristic. There's a variety of things that can do help us to connect these dots. Another way this can be done is to make some comparisons with this film, circa 1977, and other popular films from that same year. Probably the best example I can think of when it comes to comparing what exactly the bad guys of Star Wars are supposed to be is looking at the film A Bridge Too Far. This 1977 World War II film does exactly what Star Wars is trying to do. It's about paratroopers who are put behind enemy lines and have to face overwhelming odds from the enemy forces, in this case the ultimate evil, and that being Nazis. That Nazi empire could very well be a good analogy for what we're looking at here with Star Wars A New Hope. If you look at some of the imagery that this film puts out here, this is not a comparison that's brand new, right? I think a lot of people have, over time, made commentary on how much the Star Wars universe does mimic the Nazi regime. These are just some images that were found online. Again, I didn't make these images myself. And it's just part of the sort of, again, anecdotal conversation to how we might build up this analogy that the Star Wars empire and those bad guys are connected to the historical bad guys, again, at least in American mindset, of the Nazis. So take note of this first picture here, where you have the Star Wars officers, right? The way they're standing, their uniforms, their facial expressions can easily be analogous to Nazi officers during World War II, right? And again, George Lucas himself, the film producer, even commented that he took a lot of his influence from the perception of fear of the Nazis that still pervaded the United States in the 1970s. The second picture here, we see the military formations. The use of black and white in Star Wars is not an accident, right? Clearly, there's many militaries throughout the world that could be utilized to mimic the Star Wars characters and the Star Wars Empire. But using the black and white footage of Nazi military parades, the producers, in this case again George Lucas, intentionally used the black and white uniforms of the stormtroopers, which again, not very subtle, stormtroopers, stormtrooping, these kind of things, again, to complete this analogy of who our bad guys in this film is going to be. Something that, once again, could be an interesting conversation piece for the classroom. This becomes particularly interesting when we compare this analogy across time. So what we have here in these four films, or these four film clips, is the consistent use of Nazis and elements of fear. We have one clip here from the film Star Wars and its comparison with the live footage from Berlin circa 1936. These would be the things that would be on the minds of the audience in 1977. But we're watching this in 2023. We have the benefits of seeing what comes next. other films that utilize the same sort of imagery, such as the 1994 film Lion King, and we also have the benefits of seeing this play out in other historical events, such as the March on Charlottesville in 2017. As sort of a adage might go, you can know who the bad guys are because they march in formation, particularly when put to ominous music. So what we see, again, as we pause each of these videos here, is a number of historical analogies that we can make. Once again, the comparison to a historical situation, according to a 1977 audience, with the use of the Nazis. We see the film itself using a lot of the same military formations, as well as the color scheming of this Nazi propaganda film. But also, we can look back at our own experiences in the 1990s, where the Lion King film mimicked the Nazi march using the hyenas. And again, the historical situation, such as Charlottesville 2017, with the alt-right march that took place in the United States. All of these things are conversation points that can be sponsored by the use of this particular film, or at least clips, or maybe just the trailer of this film. So we are talking about the historical timeline of other Empire bad guys, right? These are the kind of things that can be utilized, such as switching the Soviets and the Nazis, right? This film does come out in 1977. The term evil empire, employed to describe the Soviet Union, is, again, pretty common in the historical lexicon. Simply switching communists and fascists, right? This can be a lesson plan that teachers can strategize in order to use this film effectively. As was mentioned briefly before, the use of empire in the 1970s is a bad word, right? Empire is no longer something to be proud of as it might have been, say, at the turn of the 20th century. We are in the midst of mass decolonization. British, French, Portuguese, and other empires are all falling apart. Right? These can easily be used for your analogy of the bad guys, historically speaking. But what about the United States as the bad guys? Ah, now that's an interesting discussion point, particularly given the time period of this film. The film comes out in 1977. We're not only talking about British decolonization, we have recently, in 1977, seen a major backlash against American imperialism. Right? This could very well be sort of that mental reaction to the United States' actions in Vietnam. This could be the legacy of organizations such as the Black Panthers, which were specifically stating that the United States was evil because of its imperialism. These are the kinds of things that, again, could be utilized for an analogy when you utilize Star Wars as a primary source. But another way we can look at this, we talk about, say, this film as a demonstration of empire as bad, and therefore potentially a commentary that the United States is the bad guy. Is it always what we think it's supposed to be? Which brings up another question. Are the, quote, rebels the good guys? When we're talking about rebels in the 1970s, there's no question that the lexicon, the language of rebel, is very much a positive thing, right? And then once again, we can turn to another comparison to film. Instead of comparing this to A Bridge Too Far, 1977, we go to another film, Smokey and the Bandit, also 1977. This is the kind of building spirit of the time here, primary source of films being made in this era. Smokey and the Bandit is the story of a rebel, specifically a rebel on the run from the cops. He is driving a blocker car for a bootlegging semi-truck, trying to smuggle, in this case, smuggle beer from one state to another, and being pursued by the police the entire time. I mean, it's a fun movie. It's a goofy movie. Definitely a movie that has stood the test of time in a number of ways, although when we look back at it, it does bring up a lot of interesting question marks. Why do we love our rebels so much? Why do we love Smokey and the Bandit? And why do we love our rebels against the Empire in Star Wars? Well, a number of possible explanations I could certainly be engaged with. Rebels push back against oppressive state authority. That would fit into the language of 1977 decolonization. That would fit into 1970s resistance against American imperialism in places like Vietnam. Or, again, the language of the Black Panthers, pushing back against the American identity as one of an imperialist state. Rebels often reject the rule of law. That can be seen as idealistic, maybe even romantic in some cases, particularly when it's being played by characters like Harrison Ford and Burt Reynolds. The Rebels often look back to a better time. They're not trying to destroy an existing system in order to create their own basis of power. No, what they've seen is a system that has taken over their world that they want to destroy and to restore an older time period. It's a very nostalgic sort of ideal. Oftentimes, these rebels live by a moral code, right? They're Jedi Knights, which outweighs the legal code of the Empire. Or they are simply daredevils and thrill seekers who are running from the government because they believe that people should be able to buy what they want, right? Smoking the Bandit. And a lot of times they're very popular among the, quote, small folk, or another way to put that would be the extras in the films, right? Tend to look upon these characters as the saviors and as the heroes. Think about the cheering scenes that take place in both films. Luke after he destroys the Death Star, or Smokey whenever he is on the Sifi with various other truckers. A couple of things that connect these characters, Luke and the bandits, here in our 1977 films. In both cases, their best friends are smugglers, Han Solo, or Snowman in this case, smuggling illegal contraband in the face of the authorities.
He's pounding down, loaded up and trucking. Are we gonna do what they say can't be done? We've got a long way to go and a short time to get there. I'm eastbound, just watch your bandit run.
Okay. Admittedly, a little bit of a silly example, but in both cases, running from the cops, the authorities are coming to get you, uniformed police forces are the bad guys that are firing first and are the aggressors, then the ability to escape from them is seen as something that is heroic, hence the issues of the rebels. And of course, these bootleggers are also men who live alone in their truck with their dogs.
I'm a Mog, half man, half dog. I'm my own best friend.
Okay, once again, admittedly a little silly here, but you can definitely see some of the tropes that are playing out here. There's got to be something to that, according to our 1977 audience and our 2023 counterparts. But it does bring up an interesting question about what exactly are they talking about when they say rebels in the 1970s? Because when I think of rebels in the 1970s, I think about our then vice president in 1972, Spiro Agnew, and a speech he gave in the dedication of the Stone Mountain Confederate Monument.
We must recall those principles of loyalty, dignity, and honor that shine through the lives of men we commemorate today. These are not just old virtues. They are the bedrock of idealism that underlies our hopes for future generations.
I'm sorry, did he say loyalty, dignity, and honor for those we dedicate this day? You do know he's talking about Jefferson Davis, Robert E. Lee, and Thomas Stonewall Jackson, Confederates. This is the Vice President of the United States calling former rebels patriots, loyal, and holding the virtues that will carry us into the future? That's a little twisted when you think about some of the logic that's being rationalized here in the 1970s and what's referred to as lost cause mentality. It also plays out in our 1970s films. This is the 1976 Outlaw Josie Wales, starring Clint Eastwood as a Confederate sympathetic antihero. And, of course, it plays out with the bandits. Smokey and the Bandit, an interesting storyline of fighting back against authority, but it takes on a new message when you realize the front of his car has the stars and bars. So it brings up the question, is Luke Skywalker a Confederate rebel? Is he a rebel against the system because he is trying to get back to an older system? Well, what kind of older system are we talking about? What way of life is he trying to protect? When you think about who Luke Skywalker is, how he is introduced in this film, some of his characteristics before he joins the rebellion, it does bring up some interesting points worth considering. His family owns a plantation. It's called a moisture farm in the film. Here he is in this scene buying slaves. Yes, I recognize they are droids. Yes, I recognize they are not human. The later films, will adapt this slavery metaphor much more directly, where only the bad guys own actual human slaves. Think of Princess Leia in The Return of the Jedi, or think about Anakin Skywalker in some of the prequels. Those are actual slaves. These droids are not, except that these slaves are routinely restrained and threatened with violence. When C-3PO recognizes that his master is upset when R2-D2 escapes, his first statement is, please don't disintegrate me. Why is he afraid of violence if he's not actually meant to be an analogy for an actual slave? Luke feels oppressed, while actively, if benignly, oppressing others. He is oppressing his droid slaves, who once again, he threatens with violence, while at the same time commenting on how much he hates the Empire. And even more interesting, and this is very common in films even up until 2023, is this idea of the chosen savior who is chosen because of their lineage, because of who their father was, because of what's in their bloodlines. These are things that, again, kind of smack of Confederate rebels in my mind. Here's another short scene that illustrates a very curious point when it comes to the analogy of racism and slavery and brutality in the United States.
Hey, we don't serve their kind here.
What?
You're a droid. They'll have to wait outside. We don't want them here.
Let's wait out by the speeder. We don't want any trouble.
That's an interesting scene to me, because not only does it demonstrate Luke once again oppressing his droid slaves by consenting to the overt hatred of the bartender, but this strongly smacks of Jim Crow. Jim Crow, that he is more than happy to, that Luke is more than happy to oblige with. We don't serve their kind here. Okay, again, you can make the argument they're not human, they don't consume alcohol, they take up space, maybe this is why the bartender doesn't want them, but the filmmakers know what they're doing. The filmmakers know what they're doing here. They know what's going to be in people's minds when they see a scene like that. Even if these are just droids, the idea of segregation is still going to be very much in their mind. We are talking only a couple of decades since segregation became outlawed in the United States, and let's not pretend that it's gone by the 1970s. So when I utilize this film in class, I like to ask the question, who are the bad guys in this? When I ask the question to my students, who are the ultimate bad guys in history? A lot of times I get the response, oh, Nazis, right? Hitler, the ultimate bad guy. That seems to be the obvious answer. Yeah, if you're white. So with this sort of analogy, it brings up the interesting question to ask in your classroom. Who is the most recognizable, quote, bad guy in history? A lot of times that answer will be Nazis and will be Hitler. But a lot of times that answer could very well be American Confederates. Maybe the rebels are the bad guy in these stories. So there are other ways to utilize this film as a primary source. This presentation does not deem to discuss all of them, but there are other things that you can certainly utilize this for. One in particular thing I like to do with film is to discuss the career of the actors and actresses within these films. In this case, yeah, you can look at Harrison Ford, you can look at Mark Hamill, you can look at Carrie Fisher and what they did after this film, but I, again, like to kind of look backwards at the film career of Alec Guinness, who played Obi-Wan. In particular, if you're going to start connecting dots in various classrooms, some dots that can be connected here with some of the comparisons of our good guys and bad guys, is, for instance, the film Dr. Zhivago with Alec Guinness in 1965. Incidentally, that comes out the same year as the film Sound of Music, which is also a pretty good storyline to utilize in the classroom when it comes to sort of the story of Nazi occupation of Austria. Alec Guinness also was in Cromwell, playing Charles I. Who's the real bad guy in this, right? Is it Charles I, or is it Richard Harris's character, which is going to be the titular Cromwell? Side note on that one, Richard Harris was also in The Count of Monte Cristo, should you want to go back and use that as well. These kind of dots can connect, again, using the same actors in multiple roles in order to continue our comparison, our discussion, that can all stem here with the introduction of films like Star Wars in your classroom. Speaking of films of the 1970s, another way you can utilize this film is with the introduction of second-wave feminism via characters such as Princess Leia. Think about what the features are of a second wave feminist and feminist movements. Right? The benefits that are accrued as a result of this movement, but also its limitations that we see now that we have lived through a third and potentially even a fourth wave of feminism. Which is, again, we look back at the 1970s and interpret it from a 2023 audience. Right? What exactly are we talking about when it comes to a second wave feminist movement, and how is Princess Leia a good representation? Well, she's white. She's wealthy. She gets to be a badass in her own right, as seen in this scene when she gets to fire on the stormtroopers. She does want to break the glass ceiling. She is a controller. She is powerful. She is somebody who is helping to push significant change within her own galaxy. And of course, she's the only woman in the film. Doesn't talk to other women. Does anyone remember the Bechdel test? This film does not pass. Just a spoiler note on that one. So these are all things that you can certainly consider when introducing films like Star Wars, science fiction films, for primary analysis in your classrooms. This presentation doesn't include every way this film can be utilized, but do consider just this short demonstration that provided just a few examples of the many possibilities of what can be utilized with a science fiction film like this. What I really want you to consider is, could your students do something like this? When they watch films in social studies classrooms, are they engaging with the material like this? If not, it is on the teacher to ensure that full engagement allows for effective use. And even more interesting to consider is, are we training interns and new teachers to look at films like this? Or are they still just putting the film in, hitting play, and hoping the film will speak to it for itself?